Thank you, everybody, for coming through a minor snowstorm to... Yes? You can't hear me? Can you hear me now?
Yes.
All right. Thank you, everybody, for coming here despite a minor snowstorm. And we'll get started. So welcome, everyone from the IRP, and welcome to everybody who's not a member. And for those... So Fridays at 1 is presented by the Institute for Retired Professionals, the IRP, and which was started 54 years ago. It's a peer-to-peer learning group. That means that members teach each other in some 35 seminar classes. Fridays at 1 is just one of the many activities at the IRP. So if any of our guests here are interested to find out more, go to IRP at newschool.edu or call 212-229-5682. So today, I'm delighted to introduce today's speaker. She's Maya Wiley. She's a member of our New School family, and she's the Senior Vice President for Social Justice and the Henry Cohn Professor of Urban Policy and Management at the Milano School of International Affairs at the New School. Before she joined the New School last year, she was legal counsel to Mayor Bill de Blasio and chair of the city's Civilian Complaint Review Board, a position she continues to hold today. And as you can see, she wears many hats. Today, she's going to talk about digital equity, disparity in our city and country between those who take access to broadband internet for granted and those who are without. Welcome, Maya Wiley, to Fridays at 1.
Thank you, Ken, and thank you all for coming. And I also want to thank Pam Tillis, she was here, but actually she's the one who suggested I do this, and it's a tremendous pleasure, and I very much appreciate you all coming out for this, despite our balmy weather. I'm going to try to keep this as conversational as possible. I do have slides, but it's more because I think sometimes you get bored looking at me. I want to put this issue of digital equity in a broad framework, which is to say, and I love this quote from Mabel Tooley, who is an Inuit elder and environmental justice activist, which is, "The earth is moving faster." The earth is moving faster. And we typically think about that very much in environmental terms, right? We think about climate change. We think about the impacts of climate on population, on where people live and how they're living, on the future of the earth. And rightly so. I mean, just one example is the rate of climate change over the next century is going to be 10 times faster than any climate shift recorded in 65 million years. Donald Trump. But that's only if you pay attention to science. So that's a context in which we commonly think of the Earth moving faster. It is moving faster metaphorically in many, many more ways than that we need to take account of. So one example of that, obviously, and a critical one, is technology. Ray Kurzweil, who's a futurist, has many, many quotes on this point, but the one I chose to share is, "We won't experience 100 years of progress in the 21st century. It'll be more like 20,000 years," right? And so there are lots of different examples of this. Yes, this is my favorite, and a man at the end is actually apropos, since that's actually largely who is influencing technology today, for lots of reasons, which we may talk about. In 14 years, technology will be 4,000 times more advanced. Not 14 times more advanced, 4,000 times more advanced. I actually said that to one of our professors of economics in NSSR, and she just looked at me and said, "I don't even know what that means." And I said, "Don't worry. Nobody does, no matter what they tell you." So just another example of what that means, though, in a little bit more practical terms, is that some are projecting that by 2045, a single computer's processing capability will be equal to all human brains combined. It's something called Moore's Law, which is the exponential growth of transistors and the fact, there's actually a great visual I didn't include because I thought I could bore you with like 3 hours worth of photos and images of these points, but it's a great photo I probably should have used, which shows like an airplane in the 1950s where they're loading up this huge, massive machine, which is a computer that has really a fraction of the memory of this little sun disk that then is, you know, shown in a picture next to it, right? I mean, so this really is impacting like just how fast technology is shifting and changing, and it has so many, and in so many ways with so many implications, right? There's another factor that I want to factor into how fast the Earth is moving in addition to technology. Because technology too often is discussed in the absence of humanity. So one is that, and we already know this, right? We have a vastly, vastly expanding wealth and income divide in the world, not just the country. It's a highly racialized divide as well, right? It is not a race-neutral divide. So if you look at some of this, some of the data, and I had to quote James Baldwin. I like quotes. Sometimes they say things better than I can. So for while the tale of how we suffer is never new, it always must be heard. And the point here is these divides are not new, but the size and the form of them continue to grow, right? So I don't think it would be surprising to anyone if I say this country has a long history of racial inequity, would it? No. But the form of it and its size and how it manifests continues to change. It's not static. And it has been growing. And so this is just median family income by race. If you see the blue line is median family wealth by race and ethnicity between 1963 and 2013. That's that blue top line. And the as you see, the bottom line says African American is what I'm going to point you to. $134,230 of wealth in the average for white families. For African American families, that's $11,030. By the way, that's an income neutral disparity. So what most people typically think is that income will explain the disparity, right? So if you see that kind of wealth disparity, you'll also see the income disparity. It is true that there's also an income disparity, but I will hearken you back to the subprime crisis of 2007, where what we saw actually was that if you were a black family with a household income of $150,000 a year, you were more likely to have a subprime mortgage than if you were a white family earning $50,000. So yes, there's a class divide, but it isn't just a class divide, it's also a race divide, right? And this is a continuing trend. And in fact, when you actually look at the data, and there's been some great work done on this out of Brandeis University, when you look at the data, what do you think is one of the biggest indicators of a wealth divide by race? What do you think causes it? If you had to pick one thing, one issue, what would it be? Housing. Education. Someone said it. Education's a common one. Housing's the right one. They found that housing, home ownership, and home equity accounted for 40% of the divide. All right? I could go through a whole history lesson on why that is, but I won't do that yet. But as you can see, also with Latino compared to white, we also see those wealth divides. So why am I sharing these statistics when we're talking about technology? Because the reality is we are in a time when technology and those are another factor in all those divides. And in a context where everything is shifting very rapidly on top of inequities we've already built. So when you see this image, what do you see? Kids on their phones. And what do you think? Everybody has a cell phone. Isn't it cute? Yeah, I can't get my kid's cell phone out of their hands either. That's right? Because I'm like, yeah, my kids, whether they're on a street corner, whether they're sitting in the house, they're always on their cell phones. So for most folks, you see this picture and you think, I recognize this picture. This is very familiar to me. This is my grandchildren or my children or my children's friends. I once had my daughter and her friend were sitting right next to each other in two chairs, and they were texting each other. All right. I just had to share that. These children are middle schoolers in Texas. And what they are doing is not social media. What they are doing is they're across the street from their school where they have a wireless bleed so that they can download their homework, because they have to have their homework assignments, it's all delivered online, and they don't have broadband at home. So this isn't a cute picture of some kids just hanging out doing what kids do. This is actually a picture of a racial divide that technology is neither fixing and partially created. Okay? So why did I talk about the environment and talk about technology and talk about racial wealth divide when we're talking about the digital divide? Part of it is because we have to think about the time we're in as a paradigm shift moment, in my view, right? Meaning, I don't remember who I stole this from. It's way more complex than I like, but this curve is a very common one, right? When you have massive shifts in society, you have paradigm shift coming, right? And it starts with destabilization that becomes disorientation. And then as you start to come out of a paradigm shift, right, you start to see a facilitating to a newer environment and transformation. This obviously happens over time, and most people don't see it. It's usually an invisible, it's not that the things that produce it and are happening within it are invisible. It's that we typically see it as a paradigm shift when we're in it. So environment, demography, because also the United States demographics are changing rapidly. Some of that demographic change obviously is extremely disorienting to some. I won't deliver my post-election lecture, but it's online. But it is dislocating for many, disorienting. But the point is it's not that the things that are producing the paradigm, technology, some of the things are not neutral. Some of the things are not inevitable, whether they're good or bad, right? Demographic shift is not in and of itself good or bad. How we react to it, what it represents, what we do with it may be good or bad. But I think the point is we've got a time of rapidly changing demographics where the country essentially is becoming, there is no one racial group that will be the majority very soon. It's already the case that for those 18 and under, half are not white. We are at a time when those who are 65 and older, though, are mostly white. So it's a generational gap at the same time that it's a fast shifting demographics. At the same time, technology is changing everything, and it's moving at such a fast pace, most of us can't keep up with what it even means. And I would argue that technologists can't keep up with what it means, right? Other than being able to say cars will be able to drive themselves. And we're really already there. But what does that mean, right? So all these things, and then you have climate change, which has huge impacts, obviously, on society. And again, in multiple ways, we're still debating, other than the fact that, as my daughter would say, we're all gonna die. That's her summary of where we are. So the bottom line, though, is all these things are confluenced together. Right? They're not actually separate, but it really tells us the times we're in. And all of this is on top of all the inequities we've already created in society, right? They don't happen separate from the inequity. So what that really means, I think we have to think about, is we're in a time of destabilization and disorientation. We are at, I would argue, the trough, right? And it's very hard for folks, for any of us, to figure out how do you build the new paradigm in a context of so many open questions that you can't answer, right? So usually when you provide this kind of structural analysis, people start to go, oh my God. And then my 13-year-old says, we're all gonna die. We're not all gonna die, some of us might, but I think the point here is this is not a neutral or inevitable set of circumstances that we produce inequity, that we produce a planet that is being destroyed, or that we produce greater divisions in society. So what does that mean? So I think we have to think about, when we're talking about digital equity, we have to hold a lot of things together in terms of what's happening. It doesn't mean we intervene in all of them, but we have to understand them. So the first is broadband, right? So the reason I have that at the bottom is because if you look at the technological inequities that we're building, with because we're not thinking enough about the inequity, a lot of it starts from the infrastructure, right? So technology is not technology without broadband. It's the fact that we created the worldwide, the broadband as the, and fiber as the backbone, as the infrastructural backbone of the internet. The internet rides on top of it. And then the internet of things, right? We've started talking, we've now said we've got broadband now. Okay, some rural communities are screwed, but other than that, we've got broadband, and we'll try to figure out how to fix some of that in rural communities. And we will, but urban communities are done, we're done. 80% of the population of the United States, we're good. And now we're just talking about all the Internet of Things that all this infrastructure helps us build, which is big data, right? Which is now all of a sudden we have all these mechanisms to collect and utilize data. And then that has next levels of implications like artificial intelligence, right? Machine learning, like self-driving cars being a big example then of what happens next. That rides on top of the big data though. You can't create the algorithms that start to help machines make those decisions in the absence of the data. So all these things really fit together as part of that technological picture, and every last one of them discriminates. Not one of them is neutral. Do they discriminate by design, do you think?
Money.
It's about money, definitely a factor. We'll talk about that in a minute. What else?
Politics, how the money will be spent.
Politics and how the money will be spent? Where it will be spent? I see you say it loud, because you're right. All right. Broadband fundamentally was discriminatory in how it was rolled out in this country, right? Don't worry, I won't keep torturing you with slides. But if you think about how we built the infrastructure that is the internet, that we now think of as the internet. The internet's not the infrastructure, but we can't have it without the infrastructure. It essentially, the federal government said, there are a couple of really big, big actors. By the way, some of them were universities. But a couple of them were mega corporations that have some of the infrastructure we can use and build off of to create this thing we're going to call the information superhighway. So as a matter of public policy, we made a decision in this country, largely embodied in the Clinton administration of the 1990s, to use public dollars to invest in large corporations to do infrastructure build-up. Now, if you're a phone company and you can get public dollars to basically pay your capital expenses, which is essentially, that's all it is, like, oh, we've got CapEx, we don't have to pay it anymore. The government, or we don't have to pay all of it, the government will pay some of it. But then how are you gonna, what technologies are you gonna use to do that?
Profit.
Well, profit's your motive. But what are you going to use then? Because profit's your motive. You're going to use your proprietary, you might have the shittiest proprietary system on the planet, but that's what you're going to build on. I haven't had much sleep in the past 2 weeks, so I may drop a few more curse words. Thank you. Usually I have to pay my children if I curse, but they're not here, so we're good. So, what that means is if you are a phone company and your method of delivering phone service was cable, you're going to use cable because that's already your infrastructure, and you're going to expand your infrastructure with those public dollars. Now, the other thing about those phone companies is they discriminated. They redlined in terms of telephone service communities of color, which are racially identifiable for a whole bunch of other reasons we haven't talked about that were public policy decisions, as well as private actions. But the point is that there were all these companies, and the civil rights community actually organized a coalition in the 90s to raise a red flag and say, you are about to recreate and reproduce a whole bunch of redlining on infrastructure, starting with telephones, that we're experiencing already. And the FCC basically ignored that. But what that meant was, and you literally had companies, Chicago, there are many cities where there was data collected that showed that what the companies were then doing was they were wiring the suburbs and skipping over the inner cities, right? And they actually made public statements. A lot of these CEOs made public statements. Why? And they said exactly what they were doing. They said exactly what they were doing. So can you imagine what they said? No, they didn't say that, but that was implied. What they said is, but they basically said is, that costs too much, because they didn't lay the infrastructure that they're building on top of in those communities. That costs too much. So as a business model, it makes a lot more sense to build out where we already have our infrastructure, and we'll build out the infrastructure we already are utilizing. Copper cable, you know, so different infrastructures for different companies, but a lot of that started in the 90s as cable, right? And then we'll figure out how we get there to those other communities. Well, that business model is discriminatory, right? That's essentially, it's not an intentionally discriminatory, it may be built on, I can't say that all those companies didn't make intentional decisions, but I'm saying it's a neutral business, in legal terms, it's a neutral business decision, right? It's not driven by race, it's driven by the economics. So we already have a problem even in our discourse about it in the country because it doesn't fit our model of how we talk about race discrimination, because we typically look for Bull Connor, right? You look for the person saying, you're black or you're Latino or you're Cambodian and you're not coming through this door. But in this case, what is said is, and we're still hearing it, is no, 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 no. We'll get to you. We'll figure it out somehow. It's not that we don't want to, but it's just that the numbers don't work for us right now. Now, that's a policy choice, right, to create a privately driven model versus a public investment model. And infrastructure, which is really interesting, consider the only reason the internet exists is because of public investment, starting with the Defense Department. It's also an interesting historical parallel because the highway system was expanded for the Defense Department. It's also part of what helped drive more racial segregation in housing. So whether it's roads, railroads, and now what I would call the 21st century railroad, which is broadband, it has always avoided and circled around communities of color. Because if you can't pay $100 for a subscription, the business model doesn't work because they won't get their profit margin and their capital expenses back without that subscription rate. So then the fact that low-income people are low-income people becomes a problem. So I've given you historic examples, but the truth is it's still happening every day to day on infrastructure build out. So we talk about the fact that we have eliminated the digital divide, right? The language of the 80s and 90s and early 2000s was acknowledging we had a digital divide because black people were not on computers at the same rates as whites, or Latinos were not on computers at the same rates as whites. And so it was a divide that was framed around computer access and utilization, which was actually basically not wrong early on, because the technology started, if you remember, with modems. Remember those things? And you had to have a modem hooked up to a computer, right, for DSL. Technology's gone beyond that now, but because so few black families had those modems or computers, that digital divide grew and grew and grew. But the point is, none of that had to do with the broadband infrastructure underneath it that kept getting expanded out. So now we say, and it's true, you can say, and it won't be untrue, that people are on the internet because of smartphone technology, right? And that's why the image of those kids, they can be very low income, but they'll have a smartphone, and now the technology allows you to get it on your phone. But remember, what are you using the technology for? What do you use your broadband for? Personally, just throw out some things. What are you using it for?
New York Times.
New York Times. You're getting information on it. What else?
Emails.
Family pictures. Maps. Well, directions. Right. Canvas. Well, do you, how many of you take classes? How many of you take classes? Do you have on, do you have readings assigned online? Do you read them on your smartphone? Sometimes. What if you have to write a paper for it? Well, here's my point. You're not going to use your smartphone to write your report. You can't. What if you have to download data and manipulate data? You have to have a, you can't, all this transacting that is creating learning, job opportunity, you have to fill out now, if you want to be a gas station attendant, the application for employment is online. I challenge you all to go and try to fill out a job application on your smartphone. It's ridiculous. It is absolutely ridiculous. So, but here's my point, gas station attendant. Not rocket scientist, gas station attendant. So even the most low-skilled, low-paying jobs increasingly require you to be able to transact in a way that your smartphone does not permit, in the same way that your computer would. In New York City, now go back to that history, so because I'm spending a lot of time on this infrastructure. So go back to New York City, 20% of New Yorkers do not have home broadband. Doesn't mean they aren't getting counted when people say everybody's online, right, because they have a smartphone. Home broadband is not the same thing as a smartphone. The other thing that it hides to say we've got that kind of, we've closed that digital divide, is that people who are low income on smartphones, by the way, that rate of not having broadband at home jumps to 30%, 6% if you're at or below poverty. So when you add in at or below poverty, that rate jumps dramatically. Not surprising because of cost. You can't, we spend more in New York City for less than many other cities in the world, right? So if it's going to cost you $65 a month to get some marginally decent, not even 21st century, you're not getting a gig of speed, you're not getting the kinds of speeds that allow some of the innovations that big data and artificial intelligence permit, you're not getting that, and you're paying a lot of money to not get it. And if you're low income, you can't pay it, right? You can't pay it. Which brings me back to Congress. When we're talking about healthcare, did you hear what Heifetz said about, what did he say? What? What planet is he living on? I mean, so put aside, so my point is obviously on healthcare, that's an extremely offensive statement because it suggests that people who don't have insurance or can't afford to pay groceries, their grocery bill, or pay their rent are somehow frivolously, you know. But you can't do anything in this society without that iPhone. Even if you were making a choice, it would be incredibly, from an economic standpoint, you'd be shooting yourself in the foot because you can't even get a job. You can't download your homework. It's crazy, right? But yet, that's the conversation we're having at the same time when we're actually allowing for business models to bypass communities. Because the same thing is happening in rural communities. By the way, rural communities are not all white. But to the extent we see a white divide, it's usually rural, right? it's the same business model problem, though, right? It's like the capital expense is so high that we don't want to provide the service because we can't recoup our profits. So all I'm saying is this is still happening. So the implications are dramatic, but it's still happening. There's a report that was just released today by the National Digital Inclusion Alliance, and I had an embargoed copy last night, but I couldn't download the map, or I'd show you the map because it's very powerful. But they did a study of digital redlining in Cleveland, and the maps make clear is that AT&T, and it doesn't really matter the company, unless it's a little local neighborhood company, if it's a big telecom, none of their business models are working for low income, and therefore disproportionately communities of color. If AT&T has not, their conclusion, AT&T hasn't extended fiber to the node, don't worry about that. The point is, if you don't have it in the node, you can't get it to the home or the apartment building. They haven't extended their fiber to the node in all the Cleveland census blocks where 35% poverty rates or higher are. So the map is like all this fiber all around the suburbs, and then there's Cleveland as a city, and the census tracts with 35% poverty, and there's nothing, right? So it still happens. It's not just a historic phenomenon. If you all will remember, those of you who live in New York, and part of what I was doing at the mayor's office was fighting with Verizon on Fios rollout, because we were seeing the same things here in New York City. And historically, cities have not done a good job of paying attention to the accountability of their franchisees to deliver the service they say they're going to deliver. Now, that's for a whole host of reasons, including the fact that they're allowed to keep secret a lot of their data, right? So public dollars supported the infrastructure, but you have a really hard time getting them to show you and tell you where the infrastructure is. And New York is a mess when it comes to that, although they're legally supposed to share it with us. But I'm just gonna tell you, Fios rollout, now that doesn't deal with the cost element, but every neighborhood should have gotten the infrastructure, should have gotten the fiber, which creates opportunities to do next level of, we've got small franchisees in the city who are actually trying to and seeing business model opportunities to serve small businesses, not just large businesses, and parts of the city that are haven't been reached by fiber because they have a different business model. But they would utilize and usually rent some of that fiber that Verizon's laying. That's part of the business model. So if Verizon's not laying it, that's a problem for others who might come in and try to create other business models. So that has huge implications, obviously, for who's online, how we afford it, why so many people can't, and even whether they have the infrastructure, the 21st century infrastructure. But I don't want to lose these other points about what's built on top of that when we start getting to the Internet of Things. Because the big data, that's the new business model now, is data. Data is now its own business model. The telecommunications firms are dinosaurs unless they figure out how they can monetize data, right? And that's why Comcast and some of these big corporations that have other businesses are gonna do so well. Why do you think Google's business model is different, right? Google's out here laying fiber for free in some cities, right? Google Fiber. But why is it doing that? What's its business model? They're selling data, because advertising dollars now are driven largely by the kind of data so that you can target your audience to your products, right? But that data, the other thing that's happening is everyone's big data means you got a lot of data. So now let's talk about this in the context of the election, because I can't help it. What is one of the biggest issues we heard that's troubling for democracy in this past election cycle?
Trump.
Yes. But let's go a little deeper than that. What happened in the election cycle? Security.
Fake news.
I mean, there are many things. Fake news, right? How did that fake news get generated? And, huh? Cambridge Analytica, which Steve Bannon serves as a board member, is a fundamentally, they have 500 100 data points on 20 million Americans. So they took those that data, they identified, that's so much data. Literally, if you have, this is why big data, which is really what big data is, means you have a lot of little pieces of information, but a lot of little pieces of information. So much so that if you have that kind of metadata, you can tell if a woman's gotten an abortion. You can tell if a woman's gotten an abortion with enough of that data. I mean, that's how intrusive metadata, this big data, can be. But if you can get that refined, then a company like Cambridge Analytica does what it did in this past election cycle. They tell people like Breitbart and others, right? Because there's actually a literal relationship. Steve Bannon, Cambridge Analytica, Breitbart. They identified the type of fake news that would influence which populations of people, because obviously, how many of you heard Pizzagate and went, come on, right? You knew immediately it was fake news, right? Well, you weren't the audience, and you're not the reason it went viral. You heard about it because it went viral, because Cambridge Analytica figured out the right images and the right issues to the right people, and then they had the distribution mechanisms, because it's also now a business in Macedonia and in Virginia. It's not just in there was some news about Macedonian towns that, like, their whole economy is now driven on putting together these viral packages. But there are people making $10,000 a month putting together these fake news pieces and inserting them into the right streams of the internet. So the Internet of Things is not neutral. It's not values neutral, and it's not neutral in terms of how it gets utilized, right? So that's just one example that had, people will debate how much impact that had in the election cycle, but obviously there was a point in the election where fake news on Facebook was getting more eyeballs than the top 20 news outlets in the country. You scared yet? Yeah. You're now like at my 13-year-old, we're all gonna die, right? Okay. Those are obviously the horror stories, and they're not all. And my point isn't that there's lots of good that all this data can drive too. But the question is, we haven't even confronted the fact that who has access to the infrastructure dictates who has access to innovations and uses of that infrastructure when we start to think about the Internet of Things. So we're also talking about whole swaths of population that can't do those things, right? That can't innovate in the economy, that can't own and share and utilize big data, because they just don't have the access or the tools, right? And then taking that big data, because then the other thing becomes, how do we utilize it? How do we utilize, putting aside my horror story of Cambridge Analytica, because obviously sometimes it's being used for good things, right? So what are some good things we can use big data for? That you may have heard about. Medical, definitely. Well, certainly it's a tool for organizing, right? We're not using metadata for organizing. That's my point about Cambridge Analytica. We don't have that in a lot of those spheres of resistance in terms of that access to the private company that's saying, and the bankrolling, the donor that will say, okay, we'll pay you private because we're in this with you, and we'll pay your costs so that you can make this available in the election cycle in the following ways. Environmental, certainly, right? Efficiencies, government efficiencies.
Education.
Like, so it's not that there aren't, telemedicine is, for rural communities that don't have healthcare infrastructure, is a way in which, if you don't have broadband, you can't make use of the fact that you have a tool to bridge the physical divide between you and where they're actually doctors, right, and specialists. So it's not that the technology doesn't have really good uses or applications. We have the next layer of problem, though, because we have all this big data, and then these next, we talked about how fast technology is changing things. Artificial intelligence being a really good example, right? Not the only one, but a really good example. So what is artificial intelligence? It's many things, but the one we most commonly hear about is machine learning, right? I mean, so the algorithms
that are utilized to interpret this massive big data that we have in order to tell computers how to think, right? So that quote I shared about the fact that by, you know, 2045, computers will have the capacity of all the human brains on the planet actually has real meaning. It has real meaning. So is that neutral? Why not?
Because most of it's being developed by private companies. I mean, just a few blocks from here, the IBM Watson people are doing natural machine learning around medical diagnosis using hundreds of millions of medical research documents, but they're developing it in the private economy as a subscription service.
Right. So there's both where it's developed and why. Right? So that's not neutral, why you're actually developing it, what you're utilizing it for. But let's even take that example. Who knows the, so where's that data coming from and what does it say? You know, there is social science that shows that black people don't get pain therapies for the same types of pain that white people do, for the same conditions. Or women and men. I mean, they're all kind. I'm going to focus mostly on where I know the data. But yes, they're all. The point is, they're all these. They're all. We build on all of our inequities. But what that means is, there's a lot of data that's not in there because there were discriminatory decisions about even what the data points were and who they were on, right? Because there was this whole bias, some of it very implicit, that somehow black people weren't in pain. So. Again, you can have a neutral decision that you think, and you can have the best intention even, but you can be reproducing false biases that are developed out of these other decisions. Let's take, because I sit on the Civilian Complaint Review Board, and we are very, very happy about the fact that we're going to get a rollout of police body cameras, because the way we can substantiate claims of police misconduct is that, because we have an evidentiary standard, we can't just say we believe somebody, we have to have some evidence in addition to them saying, this officer beat me with a baton. And if you don't have a witness, if you don't have another person who says, yeah, I saw it, the officer actually did beat that person with a baton, what do you use? Video, CCTV, people's smartphones when they're holding up and capturing video. So the idea of police rolling out body cams for good reasons will be helpful, right? It'll be helpful because there'll be more video that will hopefully say more about what's happening in police encounters, which is good for everyone, including for police officers who haven't violated the law and good for citizens if police officers have, right? But here's the flip side. And I'm a proponent for this reason, right? Because to me, the problem isn't that we're going to have it because it has good use. It's that it's like, how do we think about what it's used for and what it's not used for? So artificial intelligence now, and this is happening right now in Los Angeles, in Chicago, in many cities across the country, is they're undisclosed surveillance cameras. They can capture facial recognition from 600 feet. It's big data collection, right? They're not collecting the data because I think Ken just committed a crime. So now I have surveillance video that can tell me if he did or not. It's, we want as much big data as we can get. We want as many faces as we can get. And then our algorithms will sift through those faces and match to our database if we have an arrest warrant. If they are a suspect in the commission of another crime because they match a photo that was picked out of an eye, right? So using it for legitimate law enforcement purposes, but what we know from the science is those algorithms discriminate. And you have many more false positives, meaning false facial recognition of you were at that scene and you committed that crime because you're black and my facial recognition just misidentified you. And then the police go and pick you up, right? So the other way in which this is happening is at driving ads, because you all talked about ads, and that's the way we see a lot of artificial intelligence, because when you're, I don't know how aware you are of it, but how many times you're surfing the web and you're getting pop-up ads? So I love shoes, boots especially. It's a sickness. It is. And so
before I go to sleep at night, I go online and I look and see what boots are on sale. So then the next day, I go online because I got to do some research because I had to come here and I need to share some data, and I'm searching for broadband data. And all these boot ads are popping up, right? And I'm going, oh, wow, I didn't see those. Oh, wait, that's not why I'm here. That's artificial intelligence identifying me as someone who may buy boots, right? That you all are experiencing this all the time. Okay, and that's, you know, okay, we can talk about whether that's good or bad, but, right, it's, we're actually seeing artificial intelligence utilized in this way to make all kinds of decisions, like, so it's not just targeting who gets ads. We're going to be using artificial intelligence to decide who gets paroled. Who gets paroled? Who's making the decisions and what data is influencing how those algorithms have learned? How much race-neutral learning do we have in this country? I would argue not much. Okay, I'd really argue none, because we're all biased. Every last one of us has biases. All those biases are getting fed in. And then here's the other things. Who's owning the data and creating it? White men. Young white men. Well, older white men own it, and then younger white men are, right? No, by and large, this is the whitest, malest sector of the planet. Of the planet. Which, it, in and of itself, is a problem, because it's, we obviously, we have women, 18% of our engineering graduates are women. 18%. They're a small fraction of the technology sector. They're at, their research shows that when they go into the technology sector, they leave because it's so sexist, right? There's even research that shows that women are being women with math degrees are being discriminated against in hiring by tech firms because they're not acknowledging or seeing their math. Like, it, they're just blind. Their biases are so biased against what the stereotypes of women in math are so deep that they don't see the math credentials. And women with math credentials are much less likely to get the job with, than a man with the same math credentials, right? So there's all these biases are happening even in the most traditional of ways that reflects then who both is owning and making these decisions. So all of this is a system, is a complex system of interaction built on top of all our inequities. And so I think what Einstein said, and of course he was talking about the atomic bomb, but it still applies today. It has become appallingly obvious that our technology has exceeded our humanity. So we talked about AT&T's continued system, and it's not just AT&T, I'm picking on them just because there's recent data. Still seeing redlining of communities on infrastructure. Big data is a booming business with a wealth of information, sometimes being used for good, sometimes being used for ill, right? But largely and completely unregulated, and we're just collecting it. We've just decided that it's a societal good, so we'll just collect as much as we can and assume we'll figure out what to use it for. And that data is not race neutral. And then thinking about the forms. By the way, that facial recognition problem on race is not just in the US. There's studies from France, from Germany. It holds true for Asians. It holds true for Latinos. So this data has not just our problem, right? So what does that tell us? So I want to say a little. So I've said a lot of depressing things, but I know, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to. Because actually, I work in this area because I see huge possibility, right? Not inevitability, but possibility. Because this, none of this is inevitable. All of these are decisions, and they're decisions that we're making, public sector and private sector, right? So that means we can make different decisions if we understand what decisions we're making. And I think one of the things that's important here is we are at a time when a lot of the business models suck and there's a lot of bias of a lot of people, but by and large, people don't see themselves as biased or think that they're reproducing inequity. So it's not like they're running around like in the 50s and 60s and 70s. Actually, some people are, okay, let's be honest. But my point is that those fringe neo-Nazi and white supremacist groups don't represent the whole country. I don't believe that. And so most folks that are in these sectors really think of themselves as doing good and don't know what they don't know and don't know what they're assuming. But that's an opportunity. So here's what we're doing at the New School. I'll share a little bit about what we've done in the city of New York. So cities are increasingly trying to figure out, you know, we're decades behind, but trying to figure out how to do this, right? So figuring out how we can use our franchise power to create free wireless hotspots all over the city and demand that the companies serve low-income communities, not just serve Midtown Manhattan, right? And making selections based on the RFPs, based on having a clear statement about how they're going to do that and how they're, and then holding them and keeping them accountable to that. But also taking the revenue. So that's important because low-income people on cell phones largely pay as you go. So even when they're on cell phones, doesn't mean they can use that cell phone for broadband access throughout the month because they can't afford it often. So they're also they have disrupted service. So that actually helps them lower some costs, get more access, get it around the city, right? But it also gave us revenue that enabled us to actually create home internet for public housing residents. Now, we can't do 100%. We don't have enough revenue to do 100%, but we've got 600,000 people in our public housing. We're going to reach 21,000 public housing residents with home-based wireless, home, in the apartment, in public housing. That no other city's doing that. No other city is actually literally wiring public housing. And then there's a range of things we're thinking about. And other cities are, so I don't mean other cities aren't doing things, I mean, but actually it's our own form of trying to think about public broadband, right? So public because the franchise has the wireless hotspots that are free, public because there's a free service that has FCC broadband defined speeds for public housing residents for free. But then there comes this question, well, what does New School do? Because New School also has a lot of assets, and there are a lot of things that we're doing here, and I promised I'd talk about that. I mean, one, we have faculty. And we have faculty throughout the New School that are touching on these issues in various ways. So I'm obviously one, but I am far from the only one. We have faculty in media studies looking at issues of data and media and information. We have data visualization and urban ecologies in Parsons, where we've got faculty thinking about some of these issues, and including algorithms. We've got economists thinking about the labor implications of technology here at the New School. So even in multiple departments, right, we have folks using their different disciplines to think about these issues. So one thing we're doing is thinking about how do we bring all those faculty assets together and see what our research and work totals up to in ways that we can take it to a next level of being a leading edge university of thinking about digital inclusion and equity in a time of paradigm shift, right? The other thing, New School is a place of experiential learning, which is one of the reasons why I came here, right? I mean, I've been privileged to have been in a city where you could actually make decisions and make different decisions, including corporate accountability and new models of franchising and how you deliver services that are public. The benefit of a New School, though, is that we teach that way. We teach in the practical world. So I'm, for instance, teaching a digital equity lab now out of Milano, but with students from a bunch of different programs. And we're actually picking up on some of the issues the city's been working on, and the students are developing actual projects and project proposals to advance that work. So they're learning by doing, and by doing in a way that my hope is will actually help the city think about next levels of thinking. The other thing we're doing is thinking about how we're connected outside of the university. So we are in the second largest tech sector in the country. We are in the second largest tech sector in the country. We now have a forming association in New York City called Tech NYC. And a number of the folks that are coming together to create that is, because you know, you have associations of real estate developers, you have association of businesses, the tech industry didn't have its own association, it's created one. Some of the folks who are helping to create it are very socially conscious, like a Fred Wilson from Union Square Ventures, they think a lot about equity issues, actually. And so I say that to say we're figuring out how we can partner with them so we can be influencing tech, because we can't just do it in public sector. This sector is too private, and we have to think about how we're influencing both who's going into the private sector as well as the public sector, and what it means to think about these questions from a private sector perspective. And thinking about how we're engaging our community as a whole in terms of how they engage externally, right? So what career opportunities exist for people who are socially active and care and have values into how they connect into these issues post-university? So a lot of these things are still formative, but and we're participating in South by Southwest and with the MIT Media Lab. There's new forming consortium of faculty from a number of universities that are looking at technology with a human rights lens that we'll be participating in and thinking about how our research and work contributes to. So there are many, many good things and important things happening in this space at the same time that we have many troubling things happening. And I think the point is our value add as a university can be pretty significant given how transdisciplinary we are, how much talent and commitment to social justice issues we have, and how we can use that as a platform to actually push the larger public conversation about the paradigm shift we're in and what this means. And I'll share one last thing, because it's more developing, is now that we're in this context post-election of having to think about how we're digital sanctuaries, we also have to think about how we're digital sanctuaries in society, given my point about all this big data and how it can be utilized. And now that we have an administration that has made clear that it will utilize every tool in its power to both identify people it believes to be bad actors, to take government action against them, we must think about how we balance issues of safety and security with issues of social justice and human rights. So we're actually formulating and starting to have discussions about what does digital sanctuary mean and what kind of recommendations can we make, thinking about online hate speech and harassment, fake news, and how data that's being collected can be used to actually undermine people's constitutional rights. So I will stop there. I don't think I have another slide. And thank you for listening.
So it's time for questions, and just wait to get a microphone, and we'll start.
Thank you for the most informative presentation. I'd just like to know where we stand in the United States vis-a-vis other countries in the world. And
well, that's a big question. I'll answer it first on broadband infrastructure. We are far behind most industrialized nations because of the way we've chosen to build out the infrastructure. You may remember, actually, President Obama actually gave a graph, and he really called out how far so many of our large cities were behind, cities in Europe and in Asia in particular. So we generally rank well below where our wealth and industrial standing is in developed countries when you look at broadband access, both infrastructure and affordability. So we're doing really badly. We're doing really badly then on all kinds of other social measures, right? So we have significantly higher poverty rates. I mean, all the things you think about, things like infrastructure investments helping you solve, it's not surprising that we have significantly higher rates of poverty. If you think about it from, I think all countries are struggling with this question of data and human rights. One of the differences, though, is in some European countries, they have many, many more privacy protections than we have. And we're actually going to go in the wrong direction. So when we talk about that big data, Google's getting hell in Europe because of the big data issues and the privacy issues. But we're not actually doing that in the United States. And actually, with this administration, has actually committed to rolling back the privacy protections that we have on big telecoms and on big data. So we're actually going to see ourselves going in the opposite direction now.
During the Obama administration, he supported net neutrality.
Yes,
and they are committed to rolling back net neutrality. I don't know if everybody knows what net neutrality is, but could you explain it better than I could? And what impact it has on what we've been discussing.
Yep. And we as a city, actually the de Blasio administration and a lot of other mayors actually actively organized to support net neutrality. So the bottom line is net neutrality is about whether you can discriminate on content, whether a big company can discriminate against content. So the idea is big companies like Comcast that have both the pipes and then people want to buy access to their cable services and their, because they also have content, right? So the idea is you could say, oh, you want your Netflix, well, you won't load so fast unless you pay us to load faster. So then you can literally privilege content that that pays a premium to the consumer, so they'll to the end user, so they'll get more of that content. And then the other forms of content, like folks like us that put out free stuff online, comes much slower, right? So it's content discrimination, but it's based on business models. Now, it's very, very clear. But for us, there were a whole lot of other implications to net neutrality in addition to that. So that was obviously important. But it also, in order to get where we got, the FCC was changing how we think about them because we're changing. We haven't regulated this as a utility, right? We've treated it as an information service. We don't regulate information services the way we regulate utilities. So a lot of the reasons why a lot of us cared wasn't just the content discrimination, which is obviously an issue in its own right, but it was conceptually and legally changing how we would think about regulating it, because now it's a utility, not a information service. So that's a big reason why we should be concerned, because that also changes how we are going to regulate it into the future. And the other thing I wanted to flag in this is it's not just that, it's also Lifeline. Lifeline is a subsidy program for telephone service that says if you're low income and eligible, the federal government has this program that requires the telephone providers, we all pay for it, actually. It's like there's a tax on our phone service that creates a fund that then has the private telephone providers providing a low-cost phone service to low-income people. Well, that's obviously antiquated now that everyone's using they're using smartphones, not landlines, and they need broadband, not just a traditional phone line. So what the FCC did just last year was say, we're going to modernize Lifeline and say the subsidy can pay for broadband. The consumer has the choice. Now, the FCC, Chairman Pai, who opposed it from the beginning, has just said 9 new companies that were going to participate in providing Lifeline subsidies for broadband, they said no, after Chairman Wheeler's predecessor said yes. That's an indication that they're going to roll back the broadband, the modernization of the subsidy program. In fact, they want to kill the subsidy program. They actually don't even, they've called it Obama phone. There was Obamacare and there was Obama phone. So that's sort of driving that narrative of, fraud, waste, and abuse. So the point is, there are many, many, many things being rolled back. And that was a strategy that some of us were thinking, if cities that are delivering free service to low-income people can aggregate those subsidies, that's some of the ways we could make it affordable to maintain service, right? So that was actually something we were actively discussing with the FCC under the Obama administration as an innovation to take that subsidy to the next level of public service. And literally, the Obama administration is great, let's get this done, and then let's figure out next levels of thinking out how we might be able to make that happen. Needless to say, we're not having that conversation anymore.
Hi, thank you for your talk. I wanted to ask about the facial recognition stuff, and you said that it has been demonstrated to be very discriminatory towards a lot of people. So if that's known, can't there be any measures taken to correct it and make it better?
Yes.
And are those measures being taken, or are people bringing it to their attention?
So there are a couple things happening. So, like all things, the companies that are selling this to police departments are saying we have a 95% accuracy rate. Obviously, the scientists are saying, no, you don't. I mean, just from these studies that we've done, we would contest that. So there actually is a group of scientists have formed to think about how you do
data analytics on the discrimination of algorithms. But I would say the point is, as I said earlier, this stuff is moving so fast that we're utilizing it much more quickly than we're understanding it. So it's not that people aren't raising the question. The civil rights community just organized a few months ago and put out a big report challenging it. So it's already been elevated also into civil rights coalitions, and it's why more and more academics are kind of coming around about it. So it's not that nothing's happening. It's the fact that the speed with which we're excited about and using technology is often moving much faster than our ability to catch up to what's wrong.
Hello. Cambridge Analytics, you mentioned. Part of what that's related to is somebody wrote a book a long time ago called Amusing Ourselves to Death. And what it pointed to was the fact that while a lot of us here grew up with one source of news, or at least, you know, a couple of sources, so we had a common discussion going on in the country about what existed. And once we have thousands and thousands and thousands of sources, then it's no longer the case that we share anything. And so everybody is talking to the people who agree with them, and I'd like to know how we are able to overcome that.
I'm not gonna pretend like I have answers to all these questions. I think you're absolutely right that the information is now flowing so fast and so quickly because of technology, but also the way the groups are socially organized and even either targeted for information or finding information can be very perpetuating of a form of segregation, it both, you know, viewpoint and otherwise. And so you're absolutely right. And then we have the additional factor of, like, you know, bots in Twitter, where there's, like, you know, people are actually organizing, both attacking people to try to discredit them because of some of the information and views that they're sharing. So there's all kinds of bad stuff happening. And I think, so there's a lot of interesting conversations happening about how we do this. I mean, so the fake news is where, you know, a lot of us have gone because of the election cycle, recognizing that that's a good example, right, of how you can create selective pieces of information and then target it and then manipulate what people believe to be true. But there's not one solution. So some of it is how we think about a different kind of digital literacy, right? But that's not just digital literacy, like I know how to use a computer. There's a kind of a citizenship to that literacy, right? It's like how I know how to navigate, protect myself, protect others, find information, question information. So this is why technology doesn't replace humanity. I mean, that's I think the point about the quote. So we still need, there's a woman here, and this is happening more, and I'm hoping we can bring it into the public schools, but who's created this really interesting curriculum in a private high school here on exactly these issues. So they're actually, they're not teaching computer science just as technology science, they're infusing it with all these social questions and an understanding how the technology is and gets manipulated and what it means to actually navigate it, you know, as humans and with an idea of our social values and our citizenship, not in the legal sense, you know, our humanity, our common humanity. And I think we have to think about ways in which we're doing that much more and where technology is not our only mode of doing that. Right? And it's like any tool, it doesn't replace our human connection, and it can't.
Okay. So speaking about schools, what do you think are some ways that technology educators can address the digital divide, specifically tech educators who teach in underserved communities? Yeah.
So one is we have to get folks the technology, because the students can't just be kind of seeing technology in the classroom and not using it and working with it at home. And so there's some good things that have happened, like the libraries piloted a MiFi lending box service where you know, we do have the technology where if you don't have the infrastructure, you can still have access because these boxes give you a wireless signal at home. So the libraries lent 10,000 of these as a pilot. I know the public school system then relent another 5,000, and then there's looking at how to do this in schools. But then we have to train teachers. We have to train teachers not just on how to use the technology for ed tech. You know, that's you know, we keep talking about ed tech, like, because education technology can change the way we teach. But that's why I was pointing to this other high school model. It's not just whether we're using technology to teach, it's whether we're teaching what technology can be used for. And teachers have to be trained to do that. And that was my point about this other model. So rather than just being transactional about it, actually thinking about what the societal implications are and helping students see it. Center for Urban Pedagogy did this great thing in just teaching students with a hands-on project how to understand even what the technology is. See, we're so busy trying to teach students, particularly low-income students of color, here's a computer, and here's how you research online, which is important. But to understand the technology and how it works and how it's being utilized societally is a whole different kind of digital literacy. And I think it's critical for teachers to be trained on that and to utilize it that way.
It's this question of face recognition software operating sloppier on black faces than white faces. It's not clear to me how an algorithm which deals with specific data paints on a face is thrown off by the color of the face, given the structure and the shades of color and so forth that would be available. Can you help me understand how that's possible?
Definitely not. So this is the question. To my point, there's so many questions that are on. First of all, I'm not the person who will have the expertise to even identify how to answer that question. I mean, but that's the point about. There are folks who do and are trying to figure out how to identify that. But I think the point, at least the assumption embedded in the larger conversation about artificial intelligence, is the way that they're being created are infused with biases, both in terms of the data that's being used as well as some of the assumptions that the folks who are creating it are building into the algorithm. So I can't answer the precise question, but that's the kind of set of assumptions that's undergirding the analysis of where it's showing up, why it's showing up, how to fix it. And I think the question is, we have two sets of questions. How do you fix it so it's not discriminating in its actual use, right? So the false positives problems on the surveillance. But there are also these really large questions about surveillance. Huge questions about surveillance, because, you know, we're at the point where, as I said, there is enough data out there now where the NSA could tell you if you had an abortion. If it was to be mined in that way. I'm not suggesting it's being mined in that way, although I wouldn't have suggested that in October. I might suggest it now that it might be mined that way. So I think there are implications of what are we using technology for and why? And should we be using technology on all of the things that we're utilizing it for? There are clearly things we should be utilizing big data for, clearly. In terms of efficiencies and delivering services and in terms of understanding opportunities for improving healthcare. But I don't think that being a surveillance society is the implications of what we will, how we can control people is actually, we haven't confronted. We have not confronted. No one is walking around this planet thinking that someone knows deeply, intimately personal things that they might not have even told their life partner. But that's what's happening right now.
How many of us have our location devices turned on
right now?
And how many of us actually, do you know, notice when you're on your smartphone and you do a search, you're out in the street, and then you get a pop-up about whether to allow Google to do location services for you, right? Yeah. Now, it can be really convenient when you're like, yes, because I need to find the nearest gas station. But the point is, that's how the data is being collected, right? So that's why it knows where you are and what you're probably doing there if you collect enough data. Now, the good news is the big data companies understand that people are worried about it, and so that's why you saw fights, like even with the Obama administration, where companies were saying, we're not going to tell you how to open our phone, right? Apple's like, we're not going to tell you how to open our phone. But that's because they're recognizing the business interests in not making people afraid of their collection of the data. And I would say that's a good thing, right? It means that we have some private sector on our side and saying there are limits, there should be. If we treated data like we treat HIPAA, right? HIPAA rules. All right, like they are so stringent, right? I mean, I can't even have an email exchange with my daughter's doctor without using a secure system that I have to log into and that encrypts and then destroys the data after a short period of time to help meet HIPAA requirements. Well, we're not thinking about our other data that way. So I'm not even suggesting we can't collect it, but we have to think differently about what kinds of protections and rules of the road we're putting around it, and we're not. We're just in a societal mode where we're saying, it's all good. We'll collect as much as we can and figure it out later.
So Maya, this is a fantastic talk, and I want to pause for just a minute and refer to your role as Senior Vice President for Social Justice and just make you aware and open up to the floor that I know a lot of folks in the IRP and other community-related members are very interested in getting involved in some of the work that you're doing. The IRP members are already doing great work, like being conversation partners to students who are non-English native speakers, in doing outreach programs to homebound seniors, to thinking about the ways in which they can get better come together. Just recently, as a community of legal professionals, and helping advise and support international students who are facing immigration restrictions. So I just wonder if you have some ideas about ways in which folks in this community might get more connected either to the tech work or the social justice work that you're doing, and what will be the mechanisms that they might best follow?
That's an excellent question. So, and I don't have a complete answer, because in part because I'm also still learning the new school, and I'm certainly still learning the IRP, and we have the same thing coming from our students. So one of the things we've just generated that we're going to give to the New School Free Press is a list of volunteer opportunities generally around the city on issues that are relevant to folks post-election. I think there's a lot of opportunity, because as we're thinking about this idea of digital sanctuary, has multiple components that we're trying to understand. We're trying to think about what does it mean to think about a train-the-trainers model of helping people understand what their vulnerabilities are and how to protect against those vulnerabilities. So I think there are lots of opportunities, and it's probably going to be more of a question back to IRP about what kinds of interests do people have to identify where the opportunities to connect are. But that's an exciting thing to think about.
I'd just like to ask you if your daughter or your children, have you enlightened them about all this? I feel like I should go back and tell my children and my grandchildren all about this.
But this is my point about, look, I think of my kids as highly educated. They're pretty brilliant. They're 13 and 16. I raise these issues, and my daughter, my 16-year-old, who is, you know, you have white-knuckled grip on the smartphone, right? You're like prying it out at the dinner table. Uh-huh. And I've raised these issues with her, and she literally says, I'm not worried. Now, that's a typical 16-year-old response on almost everything I think she should worry about. But it's... The 13-year-old says we're all going to die, so she's not worried because we're all going to die. And the 16-year-old doesn't think she's ever going to die, and therefore is worried about nothing. There's a generational divide here on privacy. There's no question. So for those of us who see the kind of sea change in the world of privacy, I mean, some of the things that the kids are willing to just say to each other, forget the technology. I'm like, you said what? You told who what? And, you know, and my kids look at me like, why is that a private piece of information? So it's not just, I mean, if your concepts of privacy are already like all information is good and public, and, you know, and there's no reason I shouldn't say these things, then you're not going to stop at, oh, wait, someone else is collecting data on me. So I'm oversimplifying it, but it's very clear to me that I remember when my mother was horrified at the things I would share, right? And because her generation shared less than my generation, and my generation would share yet less than my kids' generation, right? So at the same time, I don't want to, we're not a monolith. No generation is monolithic. There certainly are young people out there who are opting out. And it's interesting what they opt out of. Like, so my daughter will opt out of Facebook. She's like, yeah, I'm not doing Facebook. Right, but Snapchat and Instagram. So it depends, sometimes it depends on what the thing is. So I think there's an opportunity in fake news for folks to understand how they can be manipulated. But I also think it's like all things, it's getting kids where they are in terms of their circles of concern. My daughter's a feminist. She's very serious about gender issues. So understanding how women are vulnerable online to sexual harassment, sexual assault, understanding that the government could actually track whether or not you'd have an abortion is an entry point for me with her. Because that's when she starts to go, oh, wait, what? Right? But so sometimes it's like you have, if it's just too general a conversation, it's like you're just old and don't understand the technology, which is not completely untrue. But I don't want to suggest all young people are in the same category, because there's certainly a number who are starting to opt out. And so there is a trend, and I think the interesting thing is, which I don't know, is to understand what's different about the young people who are opting out compared to the young people who are not. And I'm not suggesting people should opt out altogether, but just thinking differently about, you know, the implications.
Thank you so much. We're going to have some refreshments.